Hello and welcome to today's episode, which deals with channel selection and appointment of agent, agency agreement and payment of agency commission. Students, we will divide this chapter into two parts. One will carry channel selection and appointment of agent and the other will carry agency agreement and payment of agency commission. Students, we are doing this to understand how things work in export, export marketing and details associated with it. Thus, let's start with the basics. An export is a function of international trade whereby goods produced in one country are shipped to another country for future sales or trade. The sale of such goods adds to producing nation's gross output. Before we go any further, allow me to give you a quick introduction about myself. I am Ms. Pallavi Mohan, working since 17 plus years, both nationally and internationally. Students, let's start with understanding first part of our topic. The route through which the goods move from producer-buyer is called the channel of distribution. The distribution process includes the physical handling and distribution of goods, the passage of ownership, and the most important from the standpoint of marketing strategy, the buying and selling negotiation between middlemen, producers and consumers. To complete the exponents of the marketing mix and to get the product to the target market, channels of distributions must be developed. Every country or the target market presents the exporter with unique middlemen and distribution patterns. In essence, a channel of distribution includes the original producer at one end, the final buyer at the other end, and the middlemen between the two, that is, wholesalers, retailers, etc. The term middlemen refers to those institutions or individuals in the channel which either take title to the goods or negotiate or sell the goods in the capacity of a broker or an agent. There is a diversity of channels of distribution in the international market. One particular channel may be used to distribute a specific product in one country, while another may be used to distribute a specific product in another country. One may find the existence of long channels in one country and short ones in another country. There is absolutely no uniformity in the channel that may be selected by the producer. The structure and composition of the channel will depend on the nature of the product and the producing unit's strategy. Normally, the channel of distribution of a consumer product is longer than that of an industrial product. Appointing an agent is considered necessary where the producer cannot afford to invest the amount required to develop a sales force of his own. If he appoints an agent, he moves to wholesaler and retailers only through the agent. If agents are not appointed, the alternatives will be to go for wholesalers directly and through them to the retailer. If the producer can or the importer has a good sales force, he need not appoint any wholesaler. Also, he can directly contact retailers through his efficient sales force. Sometimes the producer may directly sell to the consumer, but this is rare in foreign marketing. For industrial goods, the common channel are as below. When the number of potential buyer is small, the producer may sell directly or through agents or brokers. If the number of buyers is large and area of the market big, one can use a distributor and through him retailers to reach the consumer. For linking the domestic and overseas channel, the exporter can use many of the entry alternatives available. One may choose to export indirectly through export house, domestic export merchants, etc. It is also common to see one exporting directly and using the various channels of distribution explained above in the foreign land. The first task of the exporter is hence to find out the possible distribution channel through which he can reach the consumer. The best channel decision is one that works best in the marketing strategy selected by the company. The channel should be an ideal one which satisfies the consumer's need and preferences. In choosing the channel, the producer has to struggle usually with what is ideal and what is available. Ideally, every company wants to select the lowest cost channel, but the lowest cost channel is not necessarily the best for the product. Various factors influence the selection of channels of distribution. They may be classified as factors relating to A. Product characteristics, B. Market characteristics, C. Company characteristics, D. Middlemen considerations, and E. Environment. One should study the various attributes of a product such as perishability, bulk, unit, prices, uses, frequency of purchase, etc. Perishability. The more perishable the product, the shorter should be the channel. Dairy and bakery products, fruits, vegetables, seafoods, etc. must reach the consumers soon after their production. They usually require direct marketing to the consumer because of the danger of repeated handling and delays. Unit value products whose selling prices are very high, example diamonds, are often sold directly through company's sales force. If unit cost is very high, it is invariably associated with complexities and product features that need to be explained in greater detail, example computers. On the other hand, when the channel of distribution can be long because they are frequently purchased and their turnover is high. Weight and bulk products that are bulky and large are usually sold directly to the consumer because of transportation difficulties. If the products can be handled lightly and transported easily, the channel may be long. Standardization. Standardized products, each unit of which is similar in color and size, weight, quality, etc., have usually indirect and lengthy channels because they are sold extensively and by brand. Stage of market development. New products are marketed by direct sales because they have low demand. Long or indirect channels can be used for established products as they can bear the cost due to higher sales. Number of purchasers. In general, it may be observed that the larger the number of customers, greater is the need for channel agents. For example, if a company produces or sells mass consumption items like soap, garments, etc., it has to select a longer chain of middlemen. Geographical distribution. If the customers of the products are widely dispersed geographically, long channels may be required to avoid delays in supplying the goods. Conversely, if the suppliers are concentrated geographically, it is easy to approach them with a shorter channel or by direct selling. Size and number of orders. When customers make frequent and regular purchase in small quantities, lengthier marketing channels may be required. Buyers of products. In some countries, government departments purchase commodities often in large quantities and on long-term basis, and hence calls for direct selling. The choice of channel also depends on the strength and weaknesses of various types of middlemen performing various functions. Service provided by middlemen. The middleman who provides the services which the company wishes to provide the customers may be chosen. Otherwise, the company will go for its own sales force. Attitude of middlemen. The middlemen are notoriously known for maximizing their profits rather than their manufacturers. If the company allows them to fix the prices of the product, they may happily agree to sell the product of the company. They will also select the product with higher returns and brands which sell most. New entrants find it difficult to sell the products unless maybe if they agree to share the marketing expenses. Availability of middlemen. The kind of specialists a producer wants may not be available or willing to cooperate. If the desired channel does not exist or the available one may belong to the competitor, it is then imperative for the firm to collect all necessary information on the distribution pattern in a given foreign market. Only then a decision on channel choice should be made. Cost of channel usage. The cost of performing marketing functions at each level of distribution and the overall cost of performing total marketing tasks have an important bearing on the choice of channel. The relative cost of working on different channels and the cash flow effectiveness should be closely examined. The channel which ensures efficient distribution at least cost and desired volume of sales is chosen. The choice of channel is also dependent on the company's factors such as financial resources. A financially weak company may engage financially strong intermediary so that it may push its sales well. On the other hand, a financially strong company will establish its own sales and distribution force in the overseas market. Size of a company. A large company already marketing a wide range of products will be in a good position to take up an additional product of the same kind and handle it in the same way. It need not think of the channel choice again. Marketing policies. The company's marketing policies such as speed of delivery, after sales service, promotional efforts, etc. also affect the choice of channel. Another important constraint in the channel decision is the general characteristics of the total environment of the foreign market. This factor includes the social, economic, and political environment. When the economic conditions indicate depression, one may go in for shorter channels to cut costs. If there is multi-point tax, then short channels are cheaper. Social and ethical considerations such as distribution of goods through black marketing involves questions of ethics and is bad for the society. From the above, it is clear that the channel decision of the company or manufacturer is influenced by a number of factors and does not enjoy complete freedom in selecting an ideal channel. One has to consider the various ethical, legal, marketing, and product considerations before reaching a final decision. In taking the decision, one has to think over the cost and control aspects of the channel. Students, let's cover the main points. First, channel of distribution is the route through which goods and services move from producer to buyer. It includes producer, exporter, middlemen, buyer, physical handling, and distribution of goods and services. Second, channel of distribution for consumer goods, from producer to agent, from agent to wholesaler, from wholesaler to retailer, and from retailer to consumer. Another could be producer to wholesaler, to retailer, and then to consumer. The third could be producer to retailer and then consumer. And the fourth could be directly from producer to consumer. Third, channel of distribution for industrial goods. Fourth, factors considered in selecting channels of distribution in international export. One of the most important decisions that an exporter needs to make is the mode of entry into a particular market. A firm wishing to export but lacking the necessary infrastructure or expertise can export through commission-based agents or distributors, local buying offices, merchant exporters, etc. In this method of exporting, the firm tends to use a foreign representative to sell its products to the end users. Advantages: a firm need not worry about acquiring lot of customers, as this is the role of local agent or distributor. It saves the exporter from additional cost involved in setting up a foreign presence and in some case a separate department or section in the home country. Reduces management time and efforts for the exporter. The local country marketing and technical issues include in some cases after sales support is the responsibility of the local agent or distributor, allowing the exporter to concentrate on production. An exporter does not need to spend time and resources building a local presence, as the local agent or distributor should have this in place. The firm benefits from the professional expertise of the local agent or distributor. It offers a low-cost entry strategy into a foreign market. Disadvantages: the possibility of losing control over the delivery of the goods or service to a foreign representative. The possibility that the agent or distributor may be overly aggressive or missell the products, thereby creating a global loss of reputation for the exporter. Customers may associate the products or service with the local agent or distributor instead of the exporters. Lower profit margins, as the agents or distributors will need a payment. Supervision cost associated with monitoring the activities of the local agents or distributors, as there may be a mismatch between the objectives and practices of the two organizations. Dubai-based firm seeking to export their products or services into foreign markets have a number of different types of agents and distributors, some of which include the following. Commission agents: they act as brokers who link an exporter's product with a foreign buyer. Usually, the agent does not fulfill the orders but passes them to an exporter for acceptance. These agents can sometimes assist with export logistics such as packing, shipping and export documentation. Export management companies, EMCs, act as an exporter's off-site export department, representing the exporter's product to potential foreign buyers. The EMC searches for business on behalf of the export firm and takes care of all aspects of the export transaction. Hiring an EMC is often a viable option for smaller exporters who lack the time and expertise to break into foreign markets on their own. An EMC provides a range of service, from negotiating export contracts to providing after-sales services. Usually, the EMCs operate on a commission basis, but some take title to the products they sell and make a profit on the markup. Export trading companies, ETCs. ETCs perform many of the functions of EMCs, however, they tend to be demand driven and transaction oriented, acting as an agent between the buyer and the seller. Most ETCs will take title to your goods for export and will pay your company directly. This arrangement practically eliminates the risks associated with exporting. However, the exporter needs to make sure that appropriate checks are made regarding the ETC. More often than not, ETC can be a good source of export opportunity. Export merchants will purchase and then repackage products for export, assuming all risks and selling the product to their own customers. This export intermediary option should be considered carefully, as your business runs the risk of losing control over your products, pricing and marketing in foreign markets. Co-exporting. In this case, an exporters allow another firm which already has an export distribution system in place to sell your product in addition to its own. Co-exporting, sometimes called piggyback exporting, has several advantages. This arrangement can help you gain immediate foreign market access. Also, all the requisite logistics associated with selling abroad are borne by the exporting company. Foreign distributors buy a product from an exporter and resell it at a profit. They maintain an inventory of the export product, which allows the buyers to receive the products quickly. Distributors often provide after-sales service to the buyers, as well as dealing with the issues involved in import country customs, regulating and processing. Foreign government buying agents. Foreign government or quasi-governmental agencies are often responsible for procurement. This form of exporting can often represent significant export potential for small exporters. Foreign country commercial attaches in the UAE can provide exporters with the appropriate in-country procurement office contact details. Broadly speaking, there are two kinds of foreign representatives, namely the commission agent and the distributor, which are described below. Commission agent. A commission agent is essentially a person appointed by the exporter to maintain a direct relationship with the customer. The commission agent does not buy and sell the goods, but merely locates business opportunities for the exporter and negotiates and concludes deals on behalf of the exporter. Working on a fixed salary or commission, that is, percentage on sales concluded and paid for, the commission agent normally carries no inventory or credit risk. The sales contact is always between the exporter and the buyer, even though the commission agent may sign it on behalf of the exporter. The exporter controls the price at which goods are sold. Apart from directly being in touch with the sales outlets, commission agents may also undertake market research on behalf of the exporter. Distributor. A distributor, usually a wholesaler or a local importer, buys goods outright from the exporter and then sells them to a customer at a profit. The distributor usually represents the interests of the exporter in a specified territory or region for an agreed range of products. There are relatively no credit risk for the exporter in such cases. The distributor holds stock and looks after local publicity and sales promotion. He or she also provides after-sales service where required. With a distributor, a more direct and deeper market penetration can be achieved, and if the distributor is well known, this choice of sales agent can be an effective way of securing a quick entry for the product in the market. The distributor may, however, represent more than one manufacturer, though not necessarily the same range of products. Usually, the exporter does not have control over the final pricing of the product, which is fixed by the distributor depending on market condition. Dubai-based exporters can identify a foreign representative in following ways. Trade journals. participate in catalog and video exhibitions, exhibit at trade shows, participate in trade missions, B2B, business to business, and Dubai Export Development Corporation, EDC. One of the most important decisions that an exporter needs to make is to select an appropriate representative in the target country. Recruiting the correct foreign representative can ensure that the exporter products are successful in the target markets. On the other hand, the wrong foreign representative can lead to not only a disastrous entry into the target market, but wasted management time and resources. The normal procedure in selecting a foreign representative is to first to identify at least 5 or 6 potential partners. The second stage usually involves the exporter meeting the key personnel of the foreign representative. This stage allows the exporter to its own strategic direction and corporate practices with that of the foreign representative. This will allow the exporter to assess if the two entities share the same corporate goals. In doing so, the exporter will also be able to evaluate the business and non-business aspects of the key personnel in the foreign entity and evaluate whether its own team will be able to work together. The third stage can be a formal due diligence of the foreign, which can cover various aspects including the following: sound financial position with a good reputation for prompt payment, ownership structure, HR issues, trade membership, ability to deliver a quality service and after sales support, ability to adequately market the products or service, legal issues. Once the due diligence has been carried out, the exporter needs to decide whether to go ahead and enter into a long-term arrangement with the foreign representative or to first have a trial period. There is no golden rule as to how long a trial period to have, but usually it is between 6 months to a year. Anything short of 6 months will not give the foreign representative sufficient time to build sales or the incentive to invest. The second decision that an exporter needs to make is to whether appoint a sole representative or to have multiple agents or distributors. Of course, the foreign representative will want to have exclusivity for a particular region or country. Whether an exporter awards exclusivity or not depends on the legal environment in the country, the size of the market, the capability and size of the foreign representative, requirements on the representative to make an initial investment, the length of the contract, performance, targets, etc. Regardless of whether an exporter works with a single or multiple foreign representatives, it is important to ensure that there is a mechanism for performance evaluation. In this way, the exporter can ensure that the foreign representative is meeting its goals. The usual aspects included in performance evaluation including the following: reports on a monthly basis, which include information on sales, inventory, after sales request and customers attended, competitors, performance, new product developments, pricing, etc. With this, we cover the first two parts of this chapter. Other two will be done next time. That is all for today. Hope you have understood. We'll see you again with the second part. Till then, take care. Bye.